Hello everybody and welcome you all. So today, as you know it very well, we're going to start working with the MongoDB, and this particular topic which we have already decided to work on, it is very interesting in this current scenario, because if you see carefully, lot many companies are moving towards NoSQL database, and there is a reason behind this why MongoDB is very, very popular. So it is not actually replacing your existing RDBMS which is there in the market, but it is giving you a complete different approach where you can be completely free from all those restrictions what a traditional RDBMS is going to offer it to you. So in this particular tutorial, we will be learning what MongoDB is all about and their advantages and some practical demonstrations. So let's get started now. So here in MongoDB, we would like to discuss about what is a MongoDB. So as we know, the MongoDB is known to be called a traditional document-based database, okay, which stores the data in a document. Okay, NoSQL means it doesn't say like no to SQL. Instead, it says not only SQL. That means it is not only SQL, but it is supporting the other approaches too. Okay, so the document based, when you talk about it, actually represents the typical hierarchical relationship using the single records. That means how the records are related with each other. So that's how exactly it represents. And it is a pure schema free environment, so that you really do not need to have a schema before you go and develop this program. So it is a pure schema less environment. Due to that, it is giving you far more better flexibility when you talk about completely unorganized environment. So what is NoSQL? So here's the idea about a NoSQL. So it is completely into the non-relational database. Like traditionally, if you see any non-relational database, you talk about typical NoSQL, it's purely into the document base. Here NoSQL does not use any tables like in rows and columns. A traditional RDBMS approach, if you see, there they are using a complete table structure. Like they talk about columns, they talk about rows and all about. So here in NoSQL, it stores the relationship data in the documents. So the different type of NoSQL databases are available. Like you talk about document based, you talk about key value based, you talk about white column based and graph based. Different options are available for the NoSQL. But the one which we are using it, MongoDB, it is a purely document based database. Now here we would like to go ahead with some demonstrations, like talking about like how MongoDB installation works and the other aspects. Okay everyone, so now we're going to start working on the first option called MongoDB installation. Okay, see, MongoDB installation is very simple. If you open a website and go for this website name called MongoDB download. If you talk about MongoDB download, you're going to see the official website called MongoDB community download is available. When you click here, so you can see it is taking the current version to 4.4.6. macOS, it by default detected my platform. However, you can select, depends on which platform you have it, and after that you will be clicking on this download. Okay, so it will get ready for, if you are from Windows, I would say in this Windows you can select appropriate option. Like two options are available, you can talk about MSI or talk about zip. My recommendation is you can stick to the zip powered portion, because it won't start any MongoDB services behind the scene. That is really helpful, because you really do not want the MongoDB to be there running unnecessary, even if it is not required. My suggestion is to stick to the zip file. So here, once the MongoDB is there, so you will be seeing there are two files available inside the MongoDB folder inside the bin. So once you download the zip, you will find two different type of files are available. Let me mention those. So inside the bin folder, you will see two files. One is called MongoD Okay, the other file which is available called Mongo. MongoD is to basically start the MongoD server, and the MongoD, Mongo is actually the client which will connect with the MongoD. Clear? So if you are in Windows environment, so once you are inside this bin folder of your zip file, you will get the MongoD. So you have to double click on this, it'll start a new command prompt. So you do not need to do anything further, just minimize this command prompt and go inside the bin folder again and click on the another binary file called Mongo. So it'll get start as a client. Okay, since I am using the MacBook, here the concept is little different about how MongoDB can be used. Okay, so this is just a basic way of how the Mongo is being used into your code. Okay everyone, so now as we are in the MacBook, so here to start MongoD, we have a very special way to start with. So here I'll start with my terminal, and here I would like to paste one very simple command to start my MongoDB database, that is called MongoD. And after that, you have to say --dbpath. It is the place where your database will be starting. And one more important thing I forgot to mention, like MongoD would not start automatically inside your Windows machine unless inside your C drive you have to create a new folder name called data, and under this you have to create a new folder name called DB, because automatically when the MongoD starts, it looks inside the C drive data inside a DB folder. There your all records will get stored. So do not forget, whenever you're trying to use the MongoD, so you must have this particular folder structure in place in your local machine, otherwise this is not gonna start. Every time you start your MongoD without this location, it automatically terminates. So to avoid those, make sure that you have this DataDB folder ready with you. However, you can also change the location of this particular folder structure, for which we will discuss it little later on. But as of now, we can see I'm giving my location, that is called --dbpath/datadb. I hit enter. You can see now my MongoDB is starting now, and since it's stuck, so I have to start the new terminal now. So here I open the another tab and type Mongo, and the moment I type Mongo, now you can see it is now connected with my MongoDB, and now it is ready. That's the first thing you need to remember. Okay, now to check which other databases are available to you, so you can just type show DBS. So it will show you the number of databases which are already there inside your existing newly installed MongoDB. But you can go back and create new database too. Here you can see some databases are already present. However, you go back and create the new databases into your system. And to create this database, we have a very simple option available here, name call use SimplyDB. If I say use SimplyDB, it automatically creates this database and take you inside. Let's see. Now you can see, you say use SimplyDB, it automatically creates, though it is not there, but automatically takes you in while creating those. Okay, so that means you are in current database name called SimplyDB. So if you are not sure which database you are in, so you can just type DBS or DB, and it will show you that your current database is SimplyDB. That's it. So your database is set, and we are all good to go ahead with our next level development. Hello everybody and welcome back. In a previous videos you have seen like how to create a database and how to identify whether my database is there or not. So if you remember, previously we have created our database using use keyword. So if I just see my databases which we have created last time, so how we can check this out? We can say show space DBS. Okay, so you can see we have got database list, but we do not have any database which we have created last time is registered here. That's quite surprising.
Because when we have created our database, it should be listed here, but it is not. Let's do one more time. I'm saying use SLDB, and I'm saying switch to SLDB. Now, when I say once again show DBS, so I still don't see my database is listed here. There is a reason. The reason is, according to the MongoDB rule, unless we have minimum one record or collection stored inside my MongoDB, it really can't show in the list. Now I want to tell you about a few important things. Now, here when we talk about called MongoDB, in this MongoDB, compared to the relational database, here the table, which is actually in RDBMS it is called, here it is called collection. Okay, DB is still called DB here. Okay, that means the database will be still called database, but row, what you use this word in a traditional RDBMS, here it is known as called document. If you remember, I told you, like, it is a document based database. So here every single record what you try to insert, it is not called a typical row, it is instead called a document. So every table is called collection, and every single row it is called document. That's what exactly the difference is. Okay, now here once it is ready, we will go ahead and talk about our next feature. Now, well, we have to basically go and create a new collection. Okay, so what you can say, db dot create collection, and here I can pass my collection name. I can say demo collection. So once it is done, I can see it is collection is created. In typical language, I can say the table is created, and now when I try to see, same show DBS, I can see my database is now listed. Okay, that's how exactly it works. So the very simplest way of how we use in my code. Well, in our previous examples, we have seen like how we can create a collection, and we can give the name, and I can see the details are listed when I say show DBS. But there's another alternative option available where you can just do that without even saying db.createCollection. Well, if I want to create a collection, I really don't need this particular functionality called create collection. I can directly use this statement name called db.sl student.insert, and here we would like to add the property like a name, and here we can say admin. Now what is that meaning is, when you say db.sl student.insert and I hit enter, you can see this an inserted one, and surprisingly when you try to say press enter, you will see this SL student is not a collection which we have created earlier. So what this line does, this line not only create the collection for you, but also add a record inside with this property called name, because that is a MongoDB, and MongoDB is always following the JSON based structure, and due to that it goes with the key and value pairs. So DB is a predefined keyword, SL student is a collection name, insert is a command through which you are trying to insert a record. Now to check how many collections are there. Okay, so we have one property called show collections. When I say show collections, I can list down those number of collections, or else I can say tables in a typical RDBMS language, which are there added in my system. So SL student in which I can see the record is inserted. So if I want to confirm, I can simply say db.sl student dot find. Find is a function through which I can list down those number of records which are added. I say find and you can see that the records are received. At the same time, when I say db dot the name call demo collection, okay, db dot demo collection dot find, I'll find no record. Reason, because this collection was created but there was no record which was inserted in. But you will see when I write this command call slstudent.insert, it not only create a new collection for me but also insert the record into my table, also called a collection. That's where exactly it is giving you the advantage. When you want the collections to be created along with the data, this is the way how you can really do this. Clear? But whenever you talk about db.createCollection, many people always think about what is the significance of having this db.createCollection. Look, db.createCollection is having its own significance. We never recommend this technique, okay, to create a collection, because when you create a collection, you always bring some restrictions, some terminology which missed out whenever you talk about this line. So having this db.createCollection, you can also offer some additional capping which is not possible when you use db.collectionName.insert. So you might be thinking what those cappings you're talking about. Let me try to brief you. When I say db.createCollection, and here we are providing the first name call, suppose student. Okay, when I say student, so after this is student, additional parameters what we can pass is this. When I say capped colon true, what do we say? Capped colon true. So you are enabling the capping. After that, the next parameter I'm going to pass, that is known as called size. In this size, we are providing the size. Suppose I'm saying 5, 2, 4, and also we are saying 2880. That is the size of 5 MB. And here we are giving call max colon 5. What exactly that meaning is? See, the meaning is very simple. Whenever we try to bring this create collection option, so capping true means you are enabling the capping. So what does that meaning is? It is trying to say in this particular collection name called student, maximum number of documents can be either 5 or less than 5. Clear? And the collective size of documents cannot be increased to more than 5 MB. That means you're trying to say either by adding the total number of 5 records, the collective size of 5 document will reach to 5 MB, okay, or else the maximum number of 5 documents can be stored. So whichever fills earlier, you may have a total number of 4 documents which are pretty heavy and they reach to the size 5 MB, and beyond that the next document won't be added, or else you can have the 5 documents which has not yet even reached. So any option will help you to achieve this. So that's where exactly you can offer the capping, but this is only possible when the user is trying to say db.createCollection. This option is not possible when you're trying to use this. So that's the benefit of having this db.createCollection, and this is what we always recommend. Well, now we would like to talk about our next feature here inside the same MongoDB. So we now know how to create a collection, how to create a database, and how to switch from one database to the another database. Now we will tell you like how to insert a document. So far we have already seen how to insert a document inside the MongoDB. Now we would like to also show you how we can insert the documents using multiple techniques. So remember one thing, MongoDB comes with two different type of documents. One is called relational document and second is called embedded document. Mostly while working with MongoDB, we always recommend you to use embedded documents because that helps you to scale up your application without any hurdle. Okay, the embedded documents means what? That means the I would say the parent record as well as the child records both stores in the same location. Fine. So how exactly that is? Let's take a look about this example. Here we would like to insert some records by saying db dot student. I do not have a student collection, but I'm just telling you db dot student dot insert. Here we would like to add some records. What I'm trying to say, the registration number, I'm just saying 1, 2, 3, 4. You can give anything. Now the next one we will talk about called name. This name we can say student 1, followed by the next one. I'm talking about which course the student has registered, so we can say course. Inside this course we would like to say the course name. So let's say course name. We are giving the course name called MCA. Okay, followed by another property called duration. Okay, I'm giving this duration is called 3 years, like that. After that, this curly braces is closing. That means, see, the idea is like, you see the course is an embedded document, because from course you have got few more properties like in course name and duration. I'm closing this and starting the another property, and that is called address. Okay, sorry, let me remove from here and from address. And address we can say one more curly braces, and inside this address we can say city. I'm giving the name called what? Bangalore. The another one we are using that is called state. Let me remove this. State colon ke. Okay, and the third property we are using that is known as called country. Here we are saying IE, that is called India. So it is closing here. Okay, and it is closing here. So the inner document and outer document both are closed. Hit enter, and now you can see the records are inserted. One thing you might notice, the course and the address, these two are embedded documents and they do not have any primary key of its own. Instead, the course and address both are directly dependent on the student object or the student database. So I will say student have the registration number, fine, and the primary key. So the primary key will be associated with the most outer document, and the inner documents are directly associated with them. And now when I try to say db dot student dot find, you can see now the records are fetched. I can understand many of you are thinking every time while adding the record we do not add any object ID, and here you might have observed and there also you have observed, then what exactly that ID is? Now let me brief you. This ID is nothing but a unique primary key your MongoDB has offered you. That means MongoDB says whichever data you are inserting it, so by default with every single document MongoDB will associate this by default property called underscore ID, which you can't even ignore. However, you can override. I haven't provided any underscore ID as a property because this is a predefined property associated with every single MongoDB document. If you want to override it, you can override from this value to any value, because if you do not pass any value, this value will be automatically provided. That is a typical hexadecimal value. However, if you want to override it, you can override the value of underscore ID, but you can't change the key name. Let's try with another record. So same record if I try to add. Let's go. I'm using call student 2. And here I'm saying 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Here if I want to override it, I can just say underscore id colon. Now I can give the value called what? 101. This you need to remember. So I'm overriding this value with 101. Now adding it, now the records are added. Now let me call find. Now you see this time the records when I fetched. So in this record, the first record contains a default underscore ID. In the second record, it is the one which I have provided. And remember one thing, in MongoDB, you really can't offer any property other than underscore ID as a primary key. Here there is no concept of having the like in composite key, which you used to do in traditional RDBMS. Here you have only underscore ID, and this is the only property which you can override it, else by default the new value will be given to you. So this is the first way of how the insert document has been done. We'll be telling you the another ways where the other documents are also added. Okay, so in the previous examples you have seen like how we can add the records, but I also tell you there is another alternative options are available if you want to insert the records in a bulk. That option is also possible in MongoDB. How we can do, let's try to understand. Here we would like to use one very simple concept called var my emp equal to, now starting with a typical object like this, and after that I'm adding this, and within this I'm adding the first property called emp id colon 1. After this, okay, now you can see it is not understanding, because that is a challenge when we talk about call the logical part, because you go with multiple lines it is not supporting. However, you have to follow the same lines. Now emp id 1, and we just give the second property called emp name. So emp id, just remove this, I just say emp id, and I say emp name colon admin. Okay, adding it here. So first record here, again I'm adding another one, that is called emp id colon 2. Okay, and now colon manager. Okay, again colon 3, and colon QA added. Okay, and this curly braces is closing. After this, your square bracket is also closing, and once it is done, you come down and say db dot new emp dot insert. Okay, and here you pass the name of the object called my emp, and you can see now it is telling you n inserted 3. That is known as called bulk insert, where you're inserting multiple records in a single shot. See how easy it is for you. Okay, now you simply use db dot, the collection name is what, your new emp dot find, and you can see now all three records are inserted with its default object id. Okay, so that's is a really nice idea to have the id to be provided. Okay, remember this statement. So you understood finally how we can add the records in a bulk. Going forward, we will also talk about which is related to your update as well as delete in your upcoming demos. Okay, but here that is the first thing which you realize it, how we can perform those kind of operations in very, very simple and straightforward manner. Okay, everyone. So now we have got three records with us. And in case if I'm planning to perform update on any of my records, how will I do this now? So we have a predefined functions available name called update function. Let's see how this update function can really work. So we use this statement name called db dot, what is my collection name, which is known as called a new EMP. Okay, dot update. Okay, so what I will do, I will say db dot new EMP dot update here. Okay, now when we talk about call update, we have a statement available. Okay, what is that? That is called EMP ID. We have called EMP name. So we say wherever the EMP ID is this, I want to change what the name. How can I do this now? Very simple. To perform this, what I would like to do now, I want to basically add few more records to give you some more better idea. You can see now here we have a call admin ID name. So I just do one thing. I just change the IDs. 1, 2, 3. I just say 4. I say 5. I say 6. Okay, and I call this again. The three records are inserted. Now let me try to call find. Now we have total number of 6 records are available, where admin is repeated, manager is repeated, QA is repeated. Now let me try to update the record. Okay, now I want to say db dot new EMP dot update. Here I would like to perform the property like in what name. I say emp name colon. I say admin. Okay, so I just close that and I use another curly braces with dollar set. Set means you want to set the new value. Here we are giving EMP name. Okay, what I want to do? I say wherever the name is admin, change to what? Admin new. That name I want to change it. Close this, and run. Now you can see it is saying n matched to 1. And the records fields are updated like this. Let me check. Well, here I will see the value called admin new is updated, but I have one more admin called admin. It is not changed, and that is something which you need to notice. What you need to notice is like when you try to perform update. So what MongoDB does, it starts from the top, find the first record, change the value or modify the value, and come out from the loop. It doesn't carry forward its search process for the next level of results. And that is something which is, I really want to do that. So in case if you are planning to change those values multiple times, so what you need to do, let's take a look. Here in the similar example, here we have a call name admin, second property we have a call manager. Let's try to say managers are repeated twice. So we just want to change to new underscore manager, and I want to update multiple values. So what I will do here, I will put comma and say multi colon true. Okay, saying multi colon true, that you want to say, hey, I want to update multiple search or multiple repetitions. Hit enter. This time you can say it is saying and match to and modify to. That means two records found and two records are modified. Let's check. There we go. We have got new manager is updated in both the location. That's something which is really awesome, because this is how you try to perform the multiple changes. Well, in our previous examples, you see like how we can perform the update part, but we have a one more beautiful feature available inside the MongoDB, and that is called how exactly we can perform upsert. Clear? Let's talk about upsert. Upsert is a combination of update and insert. Let me try to show you one magic here. Here, when we talk about call update part, you see now, here we are trying to say this point. Yeah, you see about multi-true we have used. Now here, this multi-true is we're trying to update, but let's talk about something called manager2. Enter. Now you can see it is saying no records found. Clear now, no records found. But there's one concept available name called upsert. Upsert means if I try to perform upsert, it means if the records are not available, it'll insert the record. I want to show you one simple example now. Here we are using multi-true. Okay, so as I can see, we're using something called name and we're performing this update part. So in this update part, we're using this dollar set new manager. So here, rather than using multi-true, we are saying upsert true. When I say upsert true, so what happened now? They say n matched 0 and up inserted 2 and modified with id this. That means when I try to call this find function, you'll be seeing now we have a got the another record has been added. Are we clear now? As a new record. So upsert does what? Upsert says like if the records are found, I will update it. If it is not, I will insert it. That means if I try to call the same thing, manager 2, fine. It is added as a new manager. Now if I just try to say not manager 2, I will call QA, and here we are saying emp equal to new underscore QA, and now you can see it is saying n matched 1, n upserted 0, n modified 1. So it is clearly telling you like, hey, I did not find any inserted part, but yes, I matched one record, I found one record, and the one record is updated now. That is very, very beneficial feature when you really want to perform upsert. So that is a advantage of upsert, that is what's called update plus insert. Very important feature, then depends on the requirement. If you want to add, you can certainly add this. So the way we have tried to add this upserted part, we can also try to perform the delete part also. Okay, so MongoDB also helps you to perform the delete part. And how you'll be trying to add it now? Let's try to understand. Here in my code, if I want to perform any delete part, I have this statement name called db dot the option we are using it, that is known as collection name emp new emp sorry dot we have an option name called remove. In this remove, we would like to offer the property. Okay, and what we're talking about now here, let's try to add the ID here or the name which you would like to import. So I want to say like emp name admin new. So we just say p name. Okay. And then name is called what? Admin new. Okay, emp name admin new. When I say remove, you can see it is removing the first record. So you can see now the records are removed. Fine, because there is only one admin new is available. Okay, now in a similar way, if I try to remove the property called new underscore manager. Hit enter. Now you can see the three records are removed. So it's not like update, which removes only one, update only one record. It can also eliminate more than one records at the same time. That's the benefit of remove. So now you can see we have already implemented some records. As I seen earlier, like we have performed the delete part now. Now when I try to say db dot new emp dot find, three records are available with me, 3, 4, and 6. Now when it comes to see insert part, we have seen update part, we have seen delete part, we have seen. Now it's time to basically fetch the records. So find function we've already seen, but in find function we also have some conditions, so-called queries. So in case if you want to limit the number of records into your application, you can also do that. Let's see, db dot new emp dot find, clear now. So in find you can also pick up the specific records too, like when I'm saying dot find, and here we can just say name colon admin. Here to put curly braces. It says there is no record with a name called admin because it is an EMP name, not a name. So let me change back to. Now I can say it finds one record. So like that, you can also apply a condition, okay, into your code. Now in a similar line, if you really don't want to offer any condition, okay, but you want to limit the number of records to be shown, so you have this function available name called limit two. Two means only two records. Now you can see, though I have three records, but it is only showing me two records because I have limit those number of records into my code. Also we can perform sorting in case if you want to perform the sorting in ascending and descending order, that also you can also do. So here rather than saying limit, we just put this option name called sort, and in this sort, on which property you want to sort it, that also you can mention. So we can just say emp name okay, and using ascending order or descending order, so you can just say -1. Let's go descending order. Hit. Now you can see it is showing in a descending order. Now if I just say -1, if I just say 1, what is showing you in an ascending order. So you can pick up the specific property behalf on which you can tell it should be either on descending order or ascending order. So that option really works very fine. Okay. So that's like how you can perform the queries. But remember one thing, you can also search the records based on their embedded columns too. Because if you see in a previous records, we have some records added. Okay. That is, let me try to say show collections. I will call SL student and student. Okay, db dot dot find. Okay, you can see we have records which are embedded records. Now if you want to search the records based on their embedded properties, like I'm talking about address, there's one property name called city. Fine, so if you would like to pick up those records, these are also possible. So how you can do this? Very simple. So you say db dot student dot find. Okay, so inside this find you can provide the specific properties. Like my outermost property name is called what? Address. So we are using this option called address dot dot city. So we say city. Are we clear? Colon. I'm giving the city name called what? Bangalore. Clear? Let me close this. And that's it. Okay. So we have to start passing another curly braces here. Hit enter, and you can see now I find two records, because both the records belong to what? Bangalore. So I'm getting this city Bangalore with me. That's really awesome. Like, you can also pass the city accordingly. A part of that, we also have the other details also, okay, in which you can have the conditions based on less than, greater than, or whatever values you would like to make it is available and possible. Okay, so that's how the conditions are satisfied. So suppose if you would like to pick the users, are we clear? Where the range which you would like to consider. So those are also possible. Like you can see, we have this property name called what? EMP ID 3 and 6. I just want to pick up only those records whose ID is greater than what? 2. So what I can say, db dot new EMP, okay, dot find, and inside this find we can say the property. Okay, so what's property we're using? EMP ID. We are saying EMP ID here, colon. Here we'll be using dollar GT. GC stands for what? Greater than, colon. We're giving the value called what? 1. Fine. Close this. Run. You can see you have received 3 records, 3, 4, and 6. In case if I just look forward for higher than 5, you will see only 1 record. So greater than, that's called GT. Okay, same option. If I just say LT, you can see we have found 2 records. So less than, greater than. Okay, so that's how exactly you offer it. Okay, and also you can provide the condition, so-called limit. As I can say, find EMP ID the way we provided. So here I will not use less than. Okay. Instead, I'll be providing another property. Let me show you what. So here in EMP ID, whatever we have taken. So let me try to take the property called find, and here we are providing EMP ID, and then, and we're using another curly braces. We're using dollar in. It's very important property, dollar in, colon. Here you provide the details. I'm saying inside, so the property is 346. We are saying 3, 6. Close this, and you can see we got 2 records which matched with 3 and 6. That's the benefit of having this. Okay everyone, so in our previous example, we have already seen lot many activities. This time we are trying to offer you something very interesting feature, and that is known as called working with indexing. See, MongoDB is one of the most popular tool, and one of the reason why it is very popular because it is having the facility of having indexing. Now what exactly the index does? So friends, main job of having this index is to basically give you the concept of like how one particular document, which is huge document, in case if you would like to perform any sort of indexing inside this, how you will be applying this. So to apply indexing into my code, let's try to understand why index is really required. Without indexing and with indexing, how you'll be making a difference into the code. So to make it happen, we would like to insert some records to confirm. Okay, so what I will do is, in step number 1, previous records, if I see, I have got 46341, depends on what earlier records we had it. So we had a call new EMP. So db.newEMP.find. So we have total number of 3 records are available. So it's okay, we can have these 3 records with me. Now let me try to apply indexing. Without indexing, if I want to find a result, what outcome I'm gonna receive? So to know about how much time it gonna be taking, if I have a got large number of records with me, I'll be using this statement name called db dot, the name is called new emp dot explain, and here I'll be using one predefined functionality called execution stats. Execution stats. Okay, now here after the execution stats we'll be using dot find, we'll be using the first property here. Okay, and what user would like to find it, that you need to basically offer it. So we are giving the name called emp name colon, giving the name called QA. Okay, let's close. Okay, now when I pressed hit enter, execution stats is a predefined functionalities which will tell me when the query was executed, what exactly the query plan was. Hit enter, and now you can see a lot of details are available with me. Like you can see parse query, winning plan and everything. One thing you need to remember, by default here when I try to run, it says end return 1, advance 1, need time, total, everything it is showing me. But one important thing which you will see here is total number of documents scanned. So it is telling me total number of document examined is 3. Clear now? And return 1, that means one result is returned and the total number of documents examines 3 in order to find this record. Just imagine a use case here. When I say total number of documents examined 3, in case if I have got millions of records with me, that means to search the record, it will examine all the millions number of records to search the result, which certainly gonna be taking huge amount of time. And that's where exactly when you try to search the record, fine, when you have no indexing is available. Okay, so you need to understand one important thing is, by default index is applied on your underscore ID db dot new emp, db dot new emp dot when I say db dot new emp dot get index is a predefined function, it tells me like, hey, by default index is applied on underscore ID. That's a fact, because by default index is applied on underscore ID, not on the other properties. So I need to identify which other properties are required to be get indexes. MongoDB advantage is it is supporting multi-column indexes, and that's what exactly we would like to see. So let's see in our next demo. Now we will try to apply indexing on our own property. Okay, so to apply the index, what we need to do, we have to say db dot, certainly we will be talking about call collection name call new emp dot create index. Here you have to pass two things. Number one, on which property you would like to apply. Okay, and it has to be ascending or descending. So I'm trying to apply on emp name and I want the index to be applied on ascending order. Okay, so here colon 1, hit enter. You can see now it is telling me like number of indexes before 1 and number of indexes after 2. That means earlier index was available only on one particular property, now it is applied on two properties. If you want, you can check. Now you can see there's another property is added called emp underscore. Now, if I try to execute a similar query which I executed earlier, QA, now you'll be seeing there's a different statistics altogether. Here, if I see in my code, see, it'll tell you total document examined 1. See, now earlier the number of document examined were 3, but since this index is applied, now it is telling me the total number of document examined is 1. So performance is certainly improved. So to search your document, it won't be searching the complete collections. Okay, rather it will search what? Only that particular column in which it is actually applied for. So that's the benefit, in fact, I would say, when you will be using these kind of indexes into your code. Okay, so hope we all are clear and understood about this concept. So let's go ahead and get this implemented into our system. Well, this is the first way of how the index can be applied. So you can also apply index on multiple properties. Clear? So that we will show you one by one how it is. Okay, everybody. So we have already seen in our previous example how we have applied indexes in our existing MongoDB application. So it is also a possibilities where we want to also apply the index on other number of properties too. As you can see in our existing database, okay, an existing collection. My collection name is new EMP, which contains two different properties. One is called EMP ID and second called EMP name. Just now we have applied index on our EMP name, but in case if I want to apply index on EMP ID, I'll be using the same technique. Okay, let's try to apply index on the same. So first of all, get indexes. I'm having this index applied on two different property. Now we would like to say db dot create index, and here in this db dot create index, we can just, I will say db dot collection name. So our collection name is called new emp dot create index. First parameter is certainly the name of which property we are applying. So here we are saying EMP ID, and in this EMP ID, we will just offer it has to be ascending or descending. Let me decide descending order. So we are saying -1. Okay, now let's press enter and check the status. Okay, now you can see earlier indexes which we have created, that was 2, and now it turns to 3. So it is very clear that index is improving. Now let's check this out. Db dot new mp dot get indexes. Now we have a total number of 3 indexes are available. So you can apply index on n number of columns if you want. Okay, at the same time, the way we have created the index, in case if I want to drop an index, so we can also drop. So what we can do, db dot new emp dot drop index, drop index, and in this drop index we have to provide which particular index we would like to drop. Remember this point, in case if you're planning to drop any sort of index, so you need to provide which index. So you should have that particular index name. Okay, so here we are providing my index name. So it should not be, I would say, the traditional name called EMP ID. No, it has to be EMP ID underscore -1 or EMP name underscore 1. So this should be the name. I'm saying EMP name. In case if you try this, you see it is saying index not found with the EMP name, because internally it maintains with this name. Let's try this out. We say EMP name underscore 1. Let's try And now you can see new index was 3, okay, 1. Okay. Now you can see we have a call emp id and underscore id. So now we have only two indexes left. There's no emp name anymore. This is how exactly you can drop the indexes. So it is very simple and straightforward way of how in MongoDB you can perform your activities. Hello everybody and welcome back. In the previous examples of MongoDB, you might have considered we have used lot many operations. In our last video, we have seen how to utilize indexing into our code. Now in our next journey of our MongoDB, we will see how aggregation works. See, in MongoDB, aggregation plays a vital role, and aggregation comes with so many handy functions with MongoDB which will help you to perform and to apply some very simple code snippets into your ongoing the requirement, which can make your query so much seamless. Now we will see how this aggregation really works, and to work on an aggregation we have taken some default database name called AggregateDB, and here we have a call student as a by default collection in which we have some set of records are already added. Now if I just want to apply aggregation, now I would like to tell you about what exactly the aggregation is. See, ideally when you talk about call aggregation, okay, so aggregation is nothing but a call aggregate, like RDBMS. If you see, we have a call aggregation there. So the Unix command, like you talk about shell pipeline, means the possibility to execute an operation on some input and use that output as an input for the next command. That means the output of one particular execution becomes an input for others. So MongoDB also supports same kind of concept in aggregation framework. There's so many type of functionalities are available, which we will see one by one into our next code. Okay, now here we want to confirm about a few important things. Now here, let me try to bring some of the important, well-known, I would say the functionalities of our aggregation framework. First, we use a term name called dollar project. The project is basically designed for select specific fields. Dollar project is designed to select what specific fields from a collection. We used to talk about called what? Dollar match. The match is responsible to filter out the operations. Are we clear now? It is designed to filtering out the operations. You talk about dollar group. Talk about dollar group. So it does the actual aggregation. Fine. We talk about call dollar sort. Okay, it basically sort the document. Okay, like that, there are so many operations that are available, which we will see one by one in our aggregation behavior. Now my first example, the one which I want to execute, I have a call student record with me, which contains a student name, okay, the section and the marks and the subject, on which subject the person or the student is appeared. Now here my first requirement is we want to filter data based on a section A, because students belong to the different sections. As you can see now, they belong to the different sections, section A, B, C, D. So I just want to filter the data based on a section A. Okay, so for filter out, I would like to use dollar match. Let's see how it works. So I just would like to filter out only those students who belong to the section A. So how we would like to use it now? I will say db dot student dot aggregate, and inside this we would like to use this square brackets and then curly braces and then use dollar match. With this I would like to use another curly braces and I say section A. Okay, and I close this close the square bracket, close this. Okay, so db.student.aggregate, aggregate should be always associate. Match is now the aggregate functionality, section A. Hit enter and you can see now it lists down all those students who belong to the section A. Okay, very simple and straightforward example. Now we would like to use the second example. So we want to find out all the records where the section is A and we are using AND operator. Marks is greater than 80. There are so many students who have a different marks like 70, 19 and whatever. So we want to use both the conditions together. So how are you going to be using this now? Remember, not only the section A, but also marks who are greater than 80. So similar thing, we have a call match. Okay, after this match, we are starting this curly braces. Okay, so after this match, we would like to bring AND. We say dollar AND. And again colon, again we are starting this square bracket now. Okay, we talk about what? Section A, number one. And after this, the first curly braces, we would like to use marks. We say marks colon and once again, we would like to start curly braces. And here we use dollar GT, that is called what? A greater than colon 80. Okay, all are closed. So you see, like here, we have got this square bracket and round brackets. So what else is left? So we have a call 80. We are using another curly braces, needs to be closed here, and then square bracket. Okay. And followed by again curly braces, again curly braces, again square bracket, again round brackets. Okay, let's see where it has gone wrong. So we are using this db.student.aggregate, we are using this square bracket, then curly braces, then we use dollar match. Okay, after the dollar match, we are using another curly braces and we have a call AND operator. After this AND, we have a call this square bracket, then curly braces, section A. After section A is getting closed, we are using another curly braces, marks colon dollar GT. Okay, and we are using what? Colon 80. After that, we are closing this and using two more curly braces, square bracket in this. Okay, so this where exactly you can utilize that. So db.student.aggregate, and like this it will be able to get it now. Okay, so in a previous example, that was the only missing point was after this this dollar match, we didn't apply this curly braces. That was the only missing point which was there, and now we have applied another code is giving me this outcome, and I have only one user who's scoring greater than 80. Well, that was the first thing which we have it now. Along with this, I would like to go ahead and talk about few more things. Now, I just would like to bring selective fields, not all the fields. Like as you can see, we have a call student name, section, marks, everything I'm getting it. So I really don't want to bring all the properties from this document. I would like to selectively take specific property. So let's talk about how we can use this. So we'll be using project. You remember about project is responsible to select the specific record. So I just use this statement name called db dot student, okay, dot aggregate, we're using it now. After that, now square bracket, then curly braces. Now we are trying to say dollar project. What we would like to use? Dollar project and colon. We are trying to use student name. Okay, colon. Okay, remember one thing. One means I want those. Zero means I don't want. So whichever property will be enabling it by giving the one as a digit, that means it is expected to be displayed. So I'm saying one, comma, I'm saying section, colon, one. Okay, and I'm also looking forward for marks, colon, one. That's it. So now, you can see now I am once again picking up only those like student, section and marks. Now if I go back and remove some properties like I only want student and section, you can see I have only student and sections are used. Here if I just use this statement name call underscore id colon zero, now you can see only the names and sections are visible, ID is not, because I really don't want ID. By default ID is shown, but if I say it's zero, that means the ID will not be visible here. So like that you can select the columns or the properties accordingly. That was the one way. Now the other thing I would like to use, what if you want to find out the student name, section and marks from student? Once again, we want to find out the student name, section and marks from the student collection where the section is A. Okay, so here it will be the combinations of match as well as the project. How we can use this? Let's take a look towards my implementation. If you see the previous one, what we have used here, you remember about, we have used this statement called aggregate match. Okay, so now we would like to go back and utilize after this dollar match. This is a curly braces. I'm giving section colon A. Okay, section colon A. And after this, I'll close this. Okay, and close this again. Again, I'm opening it up by using this option called project dollar project. We're picking up the project right now. And here with this colon symbol, we can use again and say student name colon. We're using one comma section colon one and one marks colon one. And now closing this, now you can see I got those. So the requirement was we want to find out the student name, section and marks from student collection where the section is A. So you are not only using the match, okay, but also using what, the selective details. Like this you can implement it. Okay, that's where exactly the projection really works. So projection gives you lot many opportunities which you can utilize it for your own, and also it comes with lot many predefined functions like in some AVG and all. So let's talk about those functionalities too. So this is the first thing which we have seen, aggregations are taking place. Now in case if you would like to perform the group, like if I want to find out a total marks group by, okay, section, like each and every section I would like to confirm the total marks in every section, then how will I basically do that? So let's try to get this example also. So here let me try to go back, and we will not be using match here because I would like to use the group part. So after this curly braces, we want to use dollar group. Okay, that is called group by, in RDBMS is how you use it. Here we use this curly braces again. Here we are passing this underscore ID. Okay, you have to provide underscore ID in a group because you cannot skip it. That part you need to be always remember. You really can't skip dollar ID whenever you're trying to talk about group. This is a compulsory field, you need to have it. After that, I'm using this section. In this section, we are saying dollar section, because we would like to make it on a section basis. After this, closing, and here we are using what? Total marks colon. Here, curly braces, again dollar sum, okay, colon, on which behalf I want to use in marks, so I can say dollar marks. Naming convention is very important because it is a JavaScript, so it is a case sensitive. Okay, then, and you can see now section wide I'm able to get all the marks. Isn't it amazing? That's where exactly the aggregations are playing very important role while retrieving such kind of records. So hope you are clear about how we utilize this together. So in a previous example, we got it like how we are basically taking this marks in my application. Fine. So we are clear about how we are picking that up. But what in case if I would like to take marks for the specific section? So it is also possible. So we'll be using the same group, but the only thing is what we'll be bringing the match between, because here we are trying to get the all the section marks. But if you would like to bring it only for the specific section, we know it very well what we need to do. So here, before I talk about called dollar group, we can use one more curly braces here. Okay, so we can use this option called dollar match. Okay, and here we are using this option called section A. Sorry, here in dollar match we are giving this call section colon, here we are giving A. So closing this followed by the other areas like in group which you want to start now. So you can start with this curly braces, hit enter. And you can see now only the specific section you are able to receive the records, and that's very simple now. Okay, so that's where exactly you would like to perform. And there's another option, like in case if you would like to perform an average, suppose if you want to fetch the count of student in each section and total marks and average marks as well. As so total marks as well as the average marks, you want to get it. So how are you able to take it now? So it is very simple, as you have seen earlier also into our code, how we have taken called group underscore ID section, talking about section, total marks with this sum, we are also using this. After that, we can also use the average. Okay, so this is, we have taken called group underscore ID sum. So here onwards we will start. So when we say sum marks, after that, we can just put curly braces, and we can just use count. Okay, and after this, we'll be using this colon, curly braces, and use dollar sum. Okay, colon 1. Okay. And after that, I'll put comma here, and we use average, and inside this average, I will use, in curly braces, we can say dollar $AVG, okay, colon of what? Dollar marks. Very simple. So curly braces is closed. Okay, so total how many? Three curly braces will be closed. One square bracket and round brackets. And now you can see you got the average markings in each and every section. So just imagine how easy it is for you to deal with the aggregations. So aggregation seems to be a very, very simple approach provided by MongoDB that really create a difference of how the aggregation changes the way how you react to. Okay, everybody. So after going through the idea of like how we can utilize the concept of aggregation, it's time to talk about like how when it works with MongoDB. MongoDB is properly known for, I will say, for replication, that is called high availability, and that feature comes by default with MongoDB. You really don't need to install any software for this because it is a built-in feature for the MongoDB. So when you download that, it comes along with this, so no additional configuration setup is really required when it comes to the MongoDB part. Okay, so let's get started and talk about how MongoDB can offer the replication. See, the idea behind a replication is what? The idea behind a replication is like you are replicating it. Okay, so when you talk about replication, you are replicating your data to where? To the multiple childs. So here in MongoDB, we have one concept available. Okay, that is known as called master. Okay, and slaves. Okay, master is one and there will be multiple slaves. Okay, so these slaves where your records are actually stored, and this is a master which will be responsible to replicate the data to all its childs when the request comes. Due to that, in case if one particular node fails, so automatically the data will be taken from the other nodes. That's the beauty of having this master and node slave process. So to make this possible, we have a very simple option available. In MongoDB, we have one concept like called MongoDB Atlas. So there we can go and get our cluster ready. So here we start with the concept name called MongoDB Atlas. Let's search for MongoDB Atlas, and here I see MongoDB Atlas Database as a Service. See, this is a free tool. It's a cloud environment where you really don't need to install MongoDB in your local machine. It is a cloud-based MongoDB support, which is free to use with a limited amount of space. But yes, for the testing purpose, it is the best suitable. So I can start with the start free, or else I can say the login here. Okay, from there onwards, I can go ahead. Now it is getting ready. Now, this is a place from where you can start working on your cluster. See, as I've told you, like initially when you will be working on this MongoDB, it will ask you to create a cluster initially. Okay, since I already have a cluster with me, okay, so I really don't need to create it, and as a free tier, it will not allow me to have more than one cluster set up ready. So if I say create a new cluster, okay, and I say by default AWS, okay, and let me close down this notification. AWS, you can select any other cloud provider, and 8 GB RAM cloud backup cluster name. You can see now it is taking me 0.54 per hour. Reason being, because I already have a cluster with me, hence more than one cluster is not allowed in a free tier cluster. So I have to cancel this. But you can go and create a cluster the way it was offered there. So if you want to create, you can just go ahead and do nothing. Just select by default AWS, select your location, okay, give the name of the cluster. You want to give anything, you can give it here. Otherwise, let it be the by default name cluster and say create cluster. It will take a while, minimum 2 to 3 minutes, depends on the availability. It creates a cluster for you, and your cluster, once it is ready, it looks like that. Okay, So here in this application, you have to go back and understand what is there in a cluster. So when I click on cluster 0, you can see now here we have got three nodes available. One is called primary node, which is called master, as I suggested earlier. And now we have called slaves. Automatically, when the clusters are created inside this MongoDB, by default, it will be three node cluster, where the one will be the primary and two will be secondary. Based on your package, whichever you have taken it, you can increase the number of nodes later on. But as a free, I'm going to get, or I will be receiving total number of three nodes available here. So records, whichever will be stored, it will get stored automatically in both the nodes, secondary nodes. And from the primary, I can insert the record, and secondaries, I can read the records. Remember, you can't insert the records into the secondaries. You can only insert the record only in your primary record. Secondaries are not allowed to insert. So this is your replica set. Okay, these are the nodes which are available to you. So when you click on this primary here, you will see it is telling you no data available. Nothing is there because I haven't stored any records as such. So I just go back to my cluster. So initially I would like to go back and create few things now. Okay, I would like to go back and set up few initial things at a time of creating the cluster, because when a cluster is created, clear now. So in that point of time, no setting is configured. You have to do few settings now. First setting is you have to put it, remember the steps. First step will be your network access. So in network access, you have to go and you have to say add IP address. And in this add IP address, you have to select this option from which location you would like to accept. Only those IP addresses will be whitelisted. Otherwise, what you can do, you can see here in my options, I have given 0.0.0. That means all IP addresses are acceptable. So all IP addresses are used. Okay. So this you have to enable it. Otherwise, you won't be able to get this network access from any third party locations. Next, you have to talk about call database access, which is required for you to create a new user. There are already some new users are created, but it is recommended that you to go and create a new users here. Okay, so you can go back and add a new user. So by default, it is username and password is given. So you can go back and create a new user. When I say add user, you can give the username as well as the password as per your own convenience. So new user, I'm going to create it. It is known as call SL. Okay, user, and here we're giving call admin123. So SL user admin123. Remember, this will be the username and password. I'm saying add user. New user is automatically added. SL user admin123. So once you have provided this network access, database access, next you have to create a new data. So what you need to do, when you go back to your statement, okay, network access, database access, it will ask you like you want to create a new database. So I just go back to my project zero. There will be an option called collections. You have to go back and create a new collection here. Now it is retrieving the list of databases. Now you can see there are already some collections are there. AmaDB is one of the database which is there. DemoDB is there. Lot many databases are there. So you can go back and create some new database and connect through. So if I just create database, I already have a SimpliLearnDB with me. User app is already one collections I've created. So creating a database and collection is very easy. If I give you the quick demo, I say create database, give the collection name call SL demo. Okay, and give the username call AMP SL demo employee. I say create. Now you can see SL demo and create. It is there with me. So there is no record right now. And once it is there ready, so remember SL demo and employee. I'll go back to my code again project 0, and from here I can say connect, because I want to connect it. So to connect it from, because your MongoDB is already there, so you want to connect it through. So to connect it through, we have a very simple option available. You can just click on this connect option. Multiple options are there through MongoShare. Connect your third party application with the MongoDB Compass. So since I already have a MongoShare with me, so macOS, I have this macOS with me. So you can just use this line. Okay, so if you have a window, you can select your window. Since I have this macOS, I'm selecting this line. But I need to replace with this, you can see this username, okay, and you have to give the username here. I'll select it this, I open my terminal, okay, and this is, I'm just closing this and opening up another terminal here. Since I want to connect with the Mongo shell now, so what I need to do here in this, I'll just paste that. The command which I have it now, username is, you remember I told you, you call some users which you have already created. Let's check. Here, SL user, I say SL user, I hit enter. It'll ask me the password, so I've given the password admin. And now you can see it is connecting with me to this particular, see it is connecting me to this a particular replica set. You can see in a logs it is telling you very clearly, okay, saying that it is a username 4.2, and you can see it is connecting with your shard cluster, the cluster which is created, and this is where exactly I have it with me. So I'm connecting with this environment. So primary is there. So if I just want to go back and say show show collections, so I can go back and create a new collection here. Okay, so it's up to you now. By default collection which is an employee, so I can say db dot employee dot insert. And now here we can just add name. Okay, now you can see some exception is raised. So you understand. Now you can see the records are added into my primary cluster. So if I just go back and go back to my project 0 where we have got collections, here you will be getting the SL demo employee, loading the documents. So it takes time to get this, but this is where exactly you see the records will be stored. Okay, so that's where exactly it works fine for all of you. So we have this record. Okay, so when I say show collection, so we have a call employee, and I say db dot employee dot find. So I can see we have got new collection name called. This is added right now. Okay, so like this you have got the first connection established and the records has been inserted. So guys, that's what exactly the concept of MongoDB replica set.
Hi there, if you like this video, subscribe to the Simply Learn YouTube channel and click here to watch similar videos. To nerd up and get certified, click here.